time is dawn. The place, somewhere in the vast Atlantic wastes. The waters part as a squat gray shape appears. Its bulk, a swelling silhouette in the growing light of breaking day. This is a nuclear-powered and armed submarine. A product of man's seeming infinite capacity to create instruments of destruction. This submarine has no other purpose than to destroy. It is the perfect weapon, silently and secretly cruising the dark depths of the ocean. Capable of a lightning and terrifying response to any act of aggression should the unthinkable, a nuclear strike, occur. The submarine submerges to continue its lone, near endless vigil. Stealthy, menacing, the ultimate killer. For centuries, in man's relentless quest to understand and conquer his environment, there was no more tantalizing goal than the mastery of the subsea world. But the path would be long, strewn with the fanciful, the fantastic, the futile, and the fatal, as early pioneers sought the secret of motion in the deep. Myriad propulsion systems were applied in a plethora of capricious craft. Hand power, treadmills, clockwork, compressed air, and the most dangerous of all, steam. But only with the advancing technology of the Industrial Revolution would the vague submersible become the true submarine, and the elusive dream become reality. If the story of the evolving submarine was one of trial and error, adaption and plagiarism in countries spread across the globe, the term father of the submarine must still go to one man, the tenacious Irish-American John Holland. In 1900, a skeptical United States Navy finally took delivery of a small subsea craft known simply as the Holland. Unbeknown to them, their purchase, the result of 25 years of meticulous research, disappointment and rejection, was the first unqualified success in submarine history. The modern submarine was born. Its secret? The successful harnessing of a twin propulsion system, which within a decade would be, with few exceptions, the standard power source of every submarine in the world. On the surface, the Holland and its successors were powered by the revolutionary internal combustion engine, fueled by petrol, paraffin, kerosene, and later diesel. Submerged, the problem of drive without an oxygen-fed power unit was solved by the rechargeable, battery-powered electric motor. With a suitable power source found, advance followed on advance. From its earliest inception, despite protest to the contrary, there was never doubt as to the role of the submarine. It was to be a weapon of war. This had been reinforced by the invention in the 1870s of the first locomotive torpedo, self-propelled by compressed air. With its complex steerage mechanisms, this remarkable weapon, brainchild of English engineer Robert Whitehead, would be the prototype of every torpedo to follow. The submarine had been given its teeth. Yet in the years that followed, the importance of the submarine as a facet of naval warfare gained scant recognition in world naval circles, still imbued with the glories of grand fleets. By some, the submarine as a weapon was regarded as repugnant, unfair, underhand, and by one British admiral as damned un-English. One voice, however, was raised in lone prophecy. Admiral Sir John Jacky Fisher, the architect of the modern Royal Navy in the dreadnought age, caustically observed, "It is truly astounding to me how the very best amongst us absolutely fail to realize the vast impending revolution in naval warfare that the submarine will accomplish. In 1914, the storm clouds of war broke, engulfing nation upon nation in a titanic dynastic struggle. The infant submarines received a baptism of fire. Theory was put to the test, as for four grueling years, they plied their furtive trade in the waters surrounding an embattled Europe. The German submarine war plan was simple. All-out attack on the vast Allied merchant fleets to starve Britain of the means to wage war. Throughout the war, class after class of submarine was churned out from the German naval dockyards in an unbroken chain, each one in some way better than the last. Larger, with longer range, greater submerged endurance, bigger and more accurate torpedoes, stronger deck armament. The Germans had another vital asset, a great tradition in optics. All submarines had some kind of periscope, but the German submarine's optical equipment was superlative. The eyes without which submerged attack was pointless. One of the new submarines, the U-151, the Great Deutschland of 1916, would twice run the blockade to the then neutral United States, and in so doing, mark another advance in the evolution of Germany's classic lone sea raider. The world was being introduced to a formidable new weapon in sea warfare, called simply the U-boat. With no great German mercantile fleet to tackle, the Allied strategy was essentially different, based on integrated support of ground forces and the harassing of the German high seas fleet. At the core of their submarine force was the exceptional Royal Navy E-type, which, with her smaller forebear, the C-class, gave sterling service in the Atlantic and North Sea, and in aggressive raiding in the Baltic, the Black Sea, and the treacherous Turkish Sea of Marmora. Without the submarine assault on the Turkish supply lines on sea and shore, the tragedy that was Gallipoli would have been an even greater slaughter. The USA's late entry to the war at sea was a twofold boon. Her submarines reinforced the hard-pressed Allied squadrons, while her vast wealth ensured that Allied naval strength would finally break the U-boat menace, their armed convoys ending the easy plundering of the crowded sea lanes. The tools of anti-submarine warfare were still crude. Primitive sonar or ASDIC, the hydrophone, and the early depth charge. But an indelible format had been set for the future. Armed convoy versus submarine. In every submarine force, technological advance was reflected in the sophistication of tactics and in daring, born of increasing expertise and faith in the submarines. But with the ending of hostilities in 1918, the cost would have to be counted. The German Navy alone lost 178 boats, with 51 officers and 4,500 ratings. Yet the toll on the submarine forces, when weighed against the appalling carnage of the bitter, wasteful land war, put beyond doubt the immense strategic value of the submarine. Ton for ton, the most destructive weapon of the war. In the aftermath of the Great War, the response to this reality was two-faced. In public, the diplomats would profess abhorrence of the devil's device. In private, every naval power would busily engage in augmenting their submarine strength. Except, for the moment, Germany. Her great fleet scuttled, her deadly U-boats surrendered or scrapped. The forced surrender of the German submarine force allowed the victors close comparison of their own vessels with the sea raiders who had wreaked such havoc. These included the custom-built UC-5, a mine layer which had sown its lethal fields with a stealth that only the submarine could achieve. But this was only one role of the submarine which would be assessed in the post-mortem of war. The interwar years for submarine development were ones of consolidation, steady progress, but with no dramatic breakthrough. Though the path was paved with eccentricity, the submarine as battle cruiser, as aircraft carrier, and as fleet consort with the final experiments in steam. In 1936, the coronation of George VI was marked with a grand review by the Royal Navy, still the greatest maritime power in the world. Shadowing the ranks of the fleet warships was another force, a force integral to Britain's future naval strength, the Silent Service. On show by a nation who had tried to outlaw the submarine were the large ocean-going China boats, the guardians of empire. With them and the mine layers ran their smaller, more reliable sisters, the S-class submarines, built with a prophetic eye to a restless Europe. The submarine's presence in the panoply of fleet strength was clear proof that the submarine was accepted, as it had been by every other naval power. In total, 26 countries of the world possessed a submarine force of varied size, with myriad designs for a multitude of strategies. Only time would prove the value of their choice and judgment should they be embroiled in conflict as the shadows of war once more lengthened over Europe. Germany had rearmed. This time, it was not the Imperial Eagle which flew above the fatherland, but the Nazi swastika, as Adolf Hitler led the German people steadily towards his war of vengeance and conquest. In Hitler's grand design, a resurrected U-boat force was to be accorded a place not given by any other country to their submarine arm. The reasons were not obscure. A new generation of German submarines rolled from the slipways in recognition that the old enemy, Britain, must be faced, that the British Navy was too strong to be confronted, and therefore that Britain must be starved into submission. The weapon for the task, as in the last war, was to be the submarine. As commander of the force, Hitler made the inspired choice of Captain Karl Dönitz. An undistinguished veteran of the last submarine war, Dönitz was nonetheless a brilliant organizer who would change the whole face of submarine warfare. In September 1939, the waiting ended, and the U-boats already at sea struck the first blows in a sea war that would last for 5 bitter years. But the war had come too soon. The young force was in no way ready for its crucial task. A resigned naval chief, Grand Admiral Erich Raeder, could only say to his commanders, "Gentlemen, we have no choice. Total engagement. Die with dignity." Yet, allowed to choose the time and place of conflict, the submarines launched a remarkable offensive with only 57 of the 300 boats Dönitz had begged for. But quality made up for quantity. The creative drive of the German designers and the pride and resentment of the ex-submariners who had almost won a war had ensured that the U-boat production line had never ceased, that the link with the tiny kerosene-driven U-1 of 30 years before remained unsevered. the brunt of the hostilities would be borne by the now legendary Type 7 class, Das Boot. A legend not forged by her modest technical pretensions, but by the actions of her crews. Yet the Sevens, evolved from their forebears in the now familiar format, were ideal for the task. With a low conning tower only 5.2 meters above the waterline, they were hard to see from over a mile, even in daylight. At night and head-on, they were practically invisible. They could dive in under half a minute, could reach 100 meters without strain, and 200 if hard pressed. Depth and endurance at high speed were twice as good as any of their contemporaries. But still under the 8-knot barrier, which after 20 years of submarine development remained unbroken by any combat submarine. In response to slow submerged speed, and as yet unmolested by attack from armed escorts, the U-boats took to surface attack of slow quarry. While the erratic behavior of the torpedo had been studied, and this remained the submarine's main armament, the deck gun was now a feature of every submarine. This recognized that the submarine was still a submersible, an underwater torpedo boat with limited submerged endurance before coming up for air and to charge the electrics. This would be their Achilles heel. Surface defense was essential. In the early days of the savage Battle of the Atlantic, the U-boat crews enjoyed their cynically dubbed happy times. First, the easy pickings of lone merchantmen scattered across the sea lanes, caught up by the surprise, speed, and scale of the onslaught. Then, among the ill-protected convoys. The Allies faced a fearsome logistic problem. How to run an armed convoy system when the escorts did not exist? All were spread through the far-flung sea stations of the Empire. Even given an escort, anti-submarine capability was still poor. The pattern would change, but for the moment, the U-boat crews enjoyed a rich harvest, returning to port to the adulation of a doting public with their pennons, as with other forces, proclaiming the kills, including the audacious coup by ace Gunter Prien of U-47, who had sunk the battleship Royal Oak in the Royal Naval Haven of Scapa Flow. The onset of the war for British submariners was neither glamorous nor dramatic. The Royal Navy had the equal of the Germans in numbers. But of these 57, few were in home waters as the assault continued. And the U-boats even laid mines insolently and undetected in the Thames estuary itself. It would take time to recall the skilled submarine veterans from the eastern stations. Meanwhile, to swell the home force, the old H and L classes were exhumed from sedate training duties and put on a war footing. Yet their presence in the force was not on. Britain, like the USA, would be content to use and improve her pre-war designs. For the Royal Navy, this policy, cautious though it may have sounded, was based on practicality in the face of costly rearming. Yet, as if in mirror of Germany's conveyor belt system, this building on the past produced the excellent T-class patrol submarine. Cheap but stable, efficient and powerfully armed. The future would show its worth. From the outset, British and German tactics were diametrically opposed. While the U-boats pursued, the Royal Navy stood on station. In thin grey lines of blockade, they waited for their prey of fast lone warships. Ships which had the power to strike back, and did. It became confused as to who was hunter and who was hunted. But the German invasion of Norway gave the Royal Navy's submarine arm the targets in number they craved, as they took the war to the enemy. Between the 9th of April and May Day 1940, the S&T submarines, now under the overall command of ex-submarine ace Max Horton, destroyed 22 ships, including a cruiser, and crippled the German pocket battleship Lützow. The British submarines had proved the equal of Dönitz raiders. The key to Dönitz's continuing success was not the lone guerrilla submarine of World War I, but rather the dreaded Wolf Pack, whose potency it would take the Allies 3 years to master. The tactics were simple and deadly. The key to the whole process was operations control in occupied France, where the U-boat command staff orchestrated the Wolf Pack attacks, as if they too shared the crowded sea-swept bridges of the boats as they coursed through the Atlantic gales. A single convoy sighting by a lone U-boat would begin a radio dialogue between sea and shore, which would send submarines to converge on the shadowing vessel. Then, when darkness fell, the pack would surface and strike at the unsuspecting quarry, deploying as the situation demanded. Even brazenly within the convoy itself, where the escorts dare not bring their guns to bear. With the U-boats presenting such a low profile against the dark of the sky, the hapless, huddled convoy knew of an attack only when the first torpedo struck. The effects were devastating. But the belligerence worked both ways. If the torpedo was the submarine's bite, it was also its betrayer, bringing the growing number of escorts homing to the scene with their electronic paraphernalia and their increasing skill in detection of what was and what was not a submarine in the depths of the ocean. The torpedoes loosed, there was no time to celebrate victory or dwell on failure, as in a single moment, the hunter became the hunted, and the real trial for a submarine began. The battle to survive, to outwit the enemy above, in a tense, deadly game of hide-and-seek. Even if the submarine dived, once the area had been pinpointed, efficient sonar could detect the submerged marauder. A pattern of depth charges laid in a spread could, if not achieve a kill, force the enemy onto the surface, to the waiting guns of the hunter, or into the deep, the silent nightmare world which tested every sinew of a submariner's stoic resolve. Being depth charged was an experience which no submarine crew wished to repeat. The psychological strain was immense as they waited for the shock waves of an exploding charge, not knowing if this was the killing blow. As the boat shook, the hull leaked, and equipment was strewn the length of the submarine. But submariners learnt that they could survive an attack, that the depth charge was lethal only within 30 feet, that by going deep, they could avoid the dangers of an explosion under the hull, that the destroyer carried a limited number of charges, and the attack must peter out. But there was one other great fear: chlorine gas, the deadly combination of water and leaked acid from batteries disturbed in the attack. As the U-boats were harried and hounded, to the all-pervading stench of rotting vegetables, refuse, unwashed bodies, bilge and bile, was added an almost tangible odor of fear. Yet the submarines never flinched from their task of sinking ships. But to maintain the offensive against the mounting toll of Allied destruction, the submarines needed to be in peak fighting trim and constantly at sea. The logistics of supply were a nightmare. As the U-boat sweeps grew wider and the journey to safe haven on the shores of occupied France grew longer, the submarines depended more and more on the Milchkaus, converted 9 U-boats which could refuel, rearm, and even repair a submarine at sea. This bought valuable time at sea, but was a parlous exercise. Even in calm weather, safe from the probing eyes of the enemy. From the sea, and now the sky. Submarines in every theater of the war faced a new menace, which would become the greatest killer of all, the anti-submarine aircraft. For submariners, there was no more feared enemy than the skyborne predator, appearing from nowhere, fast and lethal. An aircraft's very presence, hostile or not, made surface running exhausting and dispiriting, with constant disruption of vital surface chores. Wise submariners, without shame, dived from anything with wings. In December 1941, the ruthless assault on the United States naval fleet in Pearl Harbor presaged the opening of the other great arena of submarine warfare in World War II, the Pacific Ocean. The hard-pressed German U-boat force gained an ally, Japan, and some respite, as U.S. naval focus swung from the Atlantic. The reception by the Germans of the I-130, a typical large, ocean-going Japanese submarine of World War II, marked a flourishing entente cordiale between the submarine forces of Japan and the Third Reich. At the end of their historic journey, the visitors were accorded a full state welcome, a masterpiece of propaganda. But amidst the feasting and festivities, the diplomats were at work. Dönitz promised his new ally U-boats to swell the Indian Ocean force. But, sadly for Japan, few of the larger ocean-going Type 9 boats survived the perilous 6,000-mile journey through the South Atlantic to this important cockpit of the war, where East met West. The Indian Ocean was virtually the only place where the Japanese submarines would be allowed to employ their greatest assets. The submarine's freedom of movement and surprise, the hallmarks of the ultimate guerrilla. In the first months of operations alone, the squadron sank 20 Allied merchantmen. Yet the force remained a Cinderella as attention was drawn to dramatic events in the Pacific. Throughout the early war, the efficient Japanese industrial machine poured out class after class of large attack submarines, the tools to police the ever-expanding Japanese maritime empire. But the inflexibility of Admiral Yamamoto and his naval high command cruelly dissipated the courageous efforts of skilled and dedicated submarine crews, imposing rigid adherence to orders and a stultifying strategy which tethered the submarines to the surface fleet. Too late, the Great Sea Battle of Midway from the 12th to the 15th of November 1942 showed the folly of this unbending stance, as the submarines were left wallowing in the wake of the charging warships. From this moment on, the Japanese submarine force slipped slowly towards ultimate defeat. In stark contrast, America, the sleeping giant, was fully aroused as her Navy Department finally grasped the true nature of the Pacific War. The Atlantic situation was reversed. Japan was the island nation dependent on the sea for supply. America was the aggressor, exploiting every resource to starve the enemy into submission. The whole Pacific was a war zone, and every craft upon it a potential target. By late 1942, the United States had a massive submarine building program underway, with obsolete First World War and interwar boats giving way to fast new submarines built to stand long tests of endurance in the vast Pacific. The 73 submarines of the Gatto class, with their partners, the Baleo and the Tench class, were the new killer fish which would bear the brunt of hostilities in the Sea War. America's long-range attack submarines, the famous pig boats of World War II. Built to cruise 10,000 miles without refueling, the 300-foot boats allied kill power to endurance. 10 torpedo tubes, 3, 4, or 5-inch guns, and machine guns gave the sting, while the all-electric drive of 4 diesel generators allowed 20 knots surfaced and cut down the loss of running time due to an engine failure. Diesel-electric propulsion did not drain the batteries like the more direct drive boats, saving hours of recharging and allowing more time to drill the crews who would take the war to the enemy. Submariners were a breed apart, and had to be. To have the mental and physical toughness to endure month after month in the twilight world of a submarine, but also have the skill, reflexes and nerve for the moment of attack or crisis. Training was a byword in a submarine force. They were taught the theory. They were taught the practice. They were taught to survive, or at least to believe that they could survive, could escape from an underwater grave. Only 50% of the all-volunteer US force survived a grueling weeding out as training grew more intense, with drill after drill, exercise upon exercise, and dive, 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 to shed the precious seconds that could mean the difference between life and death. As one submarine commander put it, there is no margin of error in a submarine. You are either alive or dead. The submarines that left the American bases were superb fighting machines, manned by fit, expert, and fiercely loyal crews, confident that everything had been done to maximize their success in battle. The maxim was endurance. More space meant more supplies and torpedoes. Air conditioning meant less damp faults in the electrics, as well as comfort. Water purification and daily vitamins meant a healthier, more effective crew on the long hauls at sea. Finally, complex electronics, night radar, and a fine naval intelligence system gave the crews the added tools to carry out the task, to find them, chase them, sink them. But the submarine was only as good as its weapons. For an incredible 21 months, the US submarines put up with the chronic vagaries of the ill-tested Mark 14 torpedo. In one submarine faced with the dream scene of 3 carriers in periscope view, of 10 torpedoes loosed, only one found a target. The tragic consequence of torpedo failure was a severe blow to morale and the wasted efforts of courageous crews falsely blamed for poor results. But within these limitations, and by adopting the salvo technique to raise the chances of a hit, the US submarine force pursued their task with vigor, developing and refining all the tactics hard learnt by the forces in the European Sea War. By 1944, Japan's empire was in eclipse as the zenith of the US assault in the Pacific was reached. Japan's merchant fleet, and with it her economy, was being shattered. The submarines would claim 60% of the final toll. Nor was the Imperial Navy free from the rapacious killer fish. 1944 alone saw the sinking of one battleship, 7 aircraft carriers, 2 heavy cruisers, 7 light cruisers, 30 destroyers, and 7 submarines, with numerous other vessels sunk or damaged beyond repair. No target was too small for the hungry US submarines as the toll of destruction mounted. These losses could not be sustained. By April 1945, only 4 Japanese attack submarines were operational. Any others had long since been sunk or become mere mules, blockade runners for the harassed flagging Imperial Army. The ailing submarine fleet was forced into desperate last-ditch measures employing the kamikaze-style Kaitans. But even these one-man suicide torpedoes served only as a gruesome tribute to fanatical Japanese courage and sacrifice. With these last futile gestures, 4 years of tragic misuse of a skilled, committed, and brave force were ended. Admiral Charles Lockwood's Asiatic Force, with the other submarine forces which served in the war, lost 52 of 336 submarines, but they arguably sunk the Japanese Empire. While the battle in the Pacific was played out, across the world another sea contest, equally crucial, had run its course. A battle of attrition to decide the outcome of the North African campaign, a race of supply which the Allies had won. In the calm, clear waters of the Mediterranean Sea, Mussolini's maritime pretensions were dashed, his large modern navy without commitment or good leadership humbled. Only the Italian submarine force would endow the lackluster conduct of El Duce's grand fleet with some dignity. But in the Mediterranean, they too would meet their demise. Vivid exploits from the Atlantic to Japan and early success in their homeland sea turned sour, as one by one the large ocean-going submarines were reduced to meager transports in the turning tide of war. But final Allied success was dearly bought, and no force paid more dearly than the submarines. In December 1940, a vanguard of the Royal Navy's U-class, training submarines of 1938, armed only as an afterthought, entered the inland sea and proved the most potent sea raiders of the conflict. These were the nucleus of the tough, aggressive flotilla, sailing from shell-torn Malta, who would bear the brunt of the submarine war. In the course of the savage struggle, 21 of the U-class alone would fail to return to port. Yet the burden was shared as into the arena the Royal Navy filtered its larger submarines, with highly trained young crews or battle-hardened veterans. the attacks on the vital Axis convoys and the Italian Navy continued with mounting ferocity. During the critical years from January 1941 to February 1943, more than 600 torpedoes were fired and 100 Axis vessels sunk. By 1943, the assault on Italian shipping had become a slaughter. But the price was reinforced as destroyers, mines, and the unknown fate of those submarines listed as missing added to the forlorn toll. Lucky boats like the S-class Safari returned to Britain to acclaim their Jolly Rogers, like the German U-boat Pennons, proclaiming the kills. Some boats, like the Tally Ho, would go on to triumph in the Pacific. But other submarines would never leave the Med. The T-class Thunderbolt was one. Having sunk during sea trials in June 1939 and been recovered, one of her commanders said of the Thunderbolt, "A submarine can only sink once." He was wrong. The distinguished career of this one submarine was an expression of the skill and resilience of the Allied force. Her fate, a symbol of the depredations of the vicious submarine war. Yet, for the first time, the submarine had been a crucial component of a major strategic victory. The laurels were shared. But without the submarines, there would have been no laurels at all. By mid-1943, in the long, bitter battle of the Atlantic, the Germans were losing 15 U-boats a month to the Allied hunter-killer groups. All attempts to redress the balance failed. Even with the Schnorkel breathing device, AK-AK, anti-sonar and radar decoys and coatings, and high-tech sensors of their own, the U-boats remained vulnerable. No longer was even darkness a friend, as the tables of the early war were turned and the Allies waited for the raiders to surface in the night. Dönitz told Hitler, "The enemy has new detecting gear which makes submarine warfare impossible for the first time." Hitler, Dönitz and Munitions Minister Albert Speer all realized the war was being lost, that what Germany desperately needed as top priority was a new breed of submarine. These came tantalizingly near, new submarines capable of outpacing the hunter killers. Such submarines existed, but would never reach the fleet. The fast, streamlined 21 and 23 U-boats. With virtually the same class of submarines that had confidently begun the war, the Kriegsmarine finally lost the technology race, beaten by time. On the last day of the Atlantic War, Admiral Dönitz, successor to Hitler, gave a poignant farewell to perhaps the most dedicated and most tragic force of World War II. Of a total of 39,000 men, 28,000 had been killed in action and 5,000 captured. An awesome 85%. But despite losses in every force, World War II gave the submarines an unchallengeable place in naval strategy. As an elite, ranked with seaborne air forces as the most potent weapon in the armory of any sea power. As the survivors came home from the war, the victors and the vanquished, what was perhaps unrecognized, unsung, or unknown was the sheer versatility and magnitude of the submarine's contribution. The mine laying, the covert visits to hostile shores, sea rescue, shore raiding, reconnaissance and supply, and countless special missions, some with vessels built for one task alone. Of these last, the midget submarines, the human torpedoes, and the chariots were the most unlauded, eccentric, inventive, secretive, and dangerous. When blessed with success, like the Italian two-man pig boat raids on the Royal Navy's bases in Alexandria and Gibraltar, the results were stunning in proportion to the size of the assailant. The Latin motto of the British X-6 midget, part of the force which broke the unsinkable Tirpitz, could stand for all these monstrous midgets. Pisces minimus maximorum ad patens, loosely translated, the smallest fish with the biggest appetite. All these were part of the extraordinary underwater war of World War II. Yet, within a matter of years, the submarines of every nation, of every shape, size, and sophistication, would be rendered obsolete. By the 1950s, the advent of nuclear fission had at last furnished the submarine with the power source which had been sought for over a century. The now true submarine, with almost limitless range submerged, became the quintessence of stealth. Free to cruise the deep undetected, the new nuclear submarines took their undisputed place in the covert military fencing, which for four decades would be the indelible stamp of the tension that was the Cold War. With all the latent problems of undersea mobility solved, the irresistible march of technology, harnessed for political and military ends, ensured the refinement of the nuclear enfant terrible into the absolute instrument of destruction it has become. As the delicate political maneuvering of the Cold War continued, the nuclear submarines of both superpowers were constantly at sea, patrolling in the depths of the oceans and under the polar ice cap. Their very presence posed a serious problem in each armed camp: how to combat the threat, how to detect the undetectable. The advanced technology which had created the weapon was harnessed to furnish the antidote, with advanced sensor systems, anti-submarine missile aircraft, and anti-missile missiles. In the war games of the post-war decades, the Soviet Union and the US, with her NATO partners, tested the submarines with their powerful ballistic and cruise weapon systems against their own submarine killers. Though simulated, and in uncontested waters, these computerized games of cat and mouse were a disturbing echo of very real contests in the great submarine wars. A newcomer to the world of anti-submarine warfare, the helicopter was one answer to the invisible menace created by the submarine's almost limitless submerged endurance. By sinking sensitive sonic probes into the deep, the helicopter could detect a submarine, fulfilling the role of the hydrophone, ASDIC, and radar of a fast vanishing past. But in 1982, the past met the present in the South Atlantic, as the actions of one Royal Navy submarine reinforced the potency of the submarine in a real war. The battle for the Falklands. given permission to attack, Her Majesty's nuclear-powered submarine Conqueror fired a pattern of elderly Mark 8 torpedoes at the old Argentinian cruiser General Belgrano. Two struck. The Belgrano listed to port and sank with a loss of 368 lives. From that moment on, the Argentine Navy kept their larger surface ships safe in port. This one act of war swung the balance at sea to the Royal Navy. But what was ominous was not the act itself, but that Conqueror almost certainly carried far more powerful armament. Yet even with this, her weapon system was not within a breath of the awesome armament of any one of the world's ballistic submarines prowling the seas that same day. At the present time, submarines exist, capable of destroying not cruisers, but continents. The Cold War is over, but this threat remains. Will it ever become a reality?